Once upon a time, there were two Germanies. Nope, this isn't the start of some terrible children's bedtime story. Well, I guess it could be, but that's not what we're talking about today. Instead, we're going to return our narrative to the two German countries that were established in 1949 and look at not their relationship to other countries, but instead to each other, specifically during the 1950s. The European Cold War was very much centered on the two Germanies, and how these fraternal rivals got on, or didn't, was key. I'm your host, David, and today we are looking at inter-German relations in the 1950s. This is the Cold War. It's hard to find balanced political, economic, social, and military analysis these days. And if you're watching this video, you probably know how important media literacy is. The press is financially incentivized to push content generating clicks, but thankfully, the sponsor of today's video, Ground News, is working on solving these issues. Ground News is a first-of-its-kind website and app that lets you compare how any news story is being covered across the political spectrum. But it's not just a news aggregator. It's an easy-to-use tool with tons of features to help you be more confident you're getting the full picture. The bias distribution chart shows you which media outlets are reporting on an issue and where they fall on the political spectrum, but my favorite is the blind spot feed, which allows you to see news stories that are underreported by either side of the political spectrum. If you're looking for a better way to stay informed about current events around the world, join us and check out Ground News by visiting Ground News to download the free app or by clicking the link in the description. Thanks to Ground News for sponsoring this video. Okay, so one nation, two countries. So similar and yet so different as the Allies shaped their different occupation zones and the two countries of the Federal Republic of Germany, the FRG, and the German Democratic Republic, GDR, in accordance to their needs and wills. At first glance, one could find many similarities between the two states, especially in the early years after their creation. Both had a president as the formal head of state, a chancellor and a prime minister, accordingly, as the heads of government of upper and lower chambers of a parliament representing the regions and the people. But at the same time, the two Germanies couldn't be more different. The aggressive and intense Soviet denazification and collectivization of East Germany and the radical political and economical restructure they introduced produced a diametrically different state to that of the West that still clung to a capitalist market and a more conservative political mindset. As a result, the relations between the two ideologically incompatible states were lukewarm at best and outright hostile at other times. Despite the hostile environment of the era, a chance at unification presented itself in the spring of 1952, after Stalin sent a document proposing German reunification and the creation of a neutralized and democratic state. Keep in mind that a key Soviet goal at this point was creating a territorial buffer around it, so no surprise attack, similar to Barbarossa, could ever strike Soviet territory again. Neutralizing all of Germany would be a huge step towards this. However, this proposition was viewed with suspicion in the West, as the threat of communism extending to cover the whole of Germany remained and the possibility of that new state aligning itself with the Soviet Union was seen as very real. The Chancellor of the Federal Republic, Konrad Adenauer, characterized this move as an aggressive attempt to stall the reintegration of Germany. He would later be criticized for not exploring the chance at unification, but the reality of the situation was that there was little real prospect of that anyways. At least not with the terms that would be acceptable to both the Western powers and the German people. Both sides would continue to proclaim their desire for unification, though this propaganda did little to cover the fact that no one was actually willing to seriously pursue the subject. As the Soviets formally established diplomatic relations with East Germany in 1954 and the Paris Accords of 1955 restored full West German sovereignty, and with the Federal Republic joining NATO in the same month, the prospect of unification became even more distant and complex. 3 months later, the GDR responded to the full sovereignty of the Federal Republic with Otto Grotewohl, the East German Prime Minister, rejecting secret elections for the whole of Germany and demanding, quote, that the hegemony of monopoly capitalists and large landowners had to be broken in West Germany because this was stipulated by the Allies in the Potsdam Agreements, end quote. A few weeks later, on September 26th, Walter Ulbricht, the leader of the SED, would proclaim before the Volkskammer that the Democratic Republic was a legally sound German state. For the next 15 years, the GDR's main task would be to try and achieve recognition from the Federal Republic and to get the latter to renounce their own claim of being the sole representative of the German people. The government of East Germany, in the hopes of getting some recognition, even proposed expansion of trade, athletic and cultural relations, and the improvement of transportation conditions between the two states. But by 1955, the West's policy of claiming sole sovereignty over Germany and its staunch refusal to recognize the East had become solidified in the so-called Hallstein Doctrine. But first, a quick note here since we mentioned athletics. In 1952, because the Federal Republic claimed sole sovereignty over Germany, the International Olympic Committee rejected East Germany's request to form their own Olympic Committee on the grounds that Germany already had one. Therefore, their athletes could only compete if they were part of a unified team. In 1952, the GDR refused to do so, choosing not to participate, but the two German states would compete with a combined team of athletes in the Olympic Games held in 1956, 1960, and 1964. However, the unified German team became yet another field of confrontation between the two republics, as the two rival countries bickered over which flag should be used and which anthem. In the end, a compromise was reached with Beethoven's Ode to Joy being used as the anthem and the German flag with the Olympic rings as the flag of the United Team of Germany. And now, back to the Hallstein Doctrine. Named after Walter Hallstein, a German academic and one of the founding fathers of the European Union, the doctrine prescribed that the Federal Republic would not establish or maintain diplomatic relations with any state that recognized the Democratic Republic, similar in many ways to the One China policy. As many Western countries, as well as those emerging in the global South, had more interests in the stronger West German economy, the choice was pretty obvious, and for a long time, the FDR managed to diplomatically isolate East Germany. We will point out, however, that there were cases where the doctrine wasn't applied. For example, when the GDR opened an office in Cairo, the Federal Republic didn't withdraw its own ambassador. And, of course, there was the notable exception of the USSR, who, as one of the four powers, had diplomatic relations with both countries. The Federal Republic formally established diplomatic relations with Moscow when, on September 13, 1955, Chancellor Adenauer visited General Secretary Nikita Khrushchev. That didn't mean that Bonn had recognized the GDR, of course. Just 9 days later, Adenauer once again denied recognition of the Democratic Republic before the Bundestag. In response to the formulation of the Hallstein Doctrine, the Central Committee of the SED also declared the GDR as the sole legal German state, stating, quote, "The national sovereignty of Germany begins with the GDR. The GDR is the fatherland of the nation," end quote. However, the two states policy would remain the main practical focus for East Germany. It was only after the construction of the Berlin Wall that they would begin to repeatedly press the claim that they held sovereignty over all of Germany. So, a few months later, in January 1956, the Party Congress would also proclaim economic competition with West Germany in an effort to demonstrate the superiority of the socialist economic system. It was an effort to win the hearts and minds of the masses not only in the West, but in East Germany as well. Keep in mind, by that point, millions had crossed the border into the West, dissatisfied with the GDR's economic situation. The seemingly endless brain drain that East Germany suffered was one of the key factors hurting relations between the two German states, and ultimately greatly contributed to the creation of the now famous symbol of German and Cold War division, the Berlin Wall. Okay, emigration from East to West Germany was nothing new. It began immediately with the end of the war in 1945, and because of the relatively lax border controls that existed, in the early post-war period, millions of Germans made that migration legally. It's estimated that between October 1945 and June 1946, almost 1.6 million Germans moved from the Soviet occupation zone to the West. Gradually, the border policy became stricter, but people were generally still able to cross the border, mainly to buy and smuggle goods from the other side. But this behavior was endangering the economies of both the East and the West. For the East, it meant loss of currency, and because the vast majority of the crossers were Easterners, it created the impression that the Democratic Republic was an impoverished state, while the Federal Republic was Shangri-La, the Promised Land. As for the West, the price of consumer goods skyrocketed, as the people crossing from the East seemed willing to pay ridiculous amounts of money, much to the pleasure of frontier merchants. Conrad has wares if you have coin. That was until the 26th of May, 1952, when the GDR changed its stance and implemented a special regime on the demarcation line that divided East from West. Bridges were closed, trees near the border were cut, houses were torn down, and entire communities were forced to resettle. Fences, barbed wire, and a plowed strip of land along the length of the line completed the image of the now fortified border. These measures were taken to counter, at least according to the Democratic Republic, the influx of terrorists, spies, and smugglers from the West. Ironically, the flow of immigrants going to the West actually assisted East Germany with sneaking agents over the border, as well as peacefully getting rid of potential enemies of the state. But ultimately, it mattered little whether East Germany closed the border, because it was genuinely worried about foreign influence or to limit the flow of immigrants. The social and economic impact this move would have on both Germanies would be the same. As we mentioned earlier, the economy of border towns depended largely on the other side. Severed from their markets and sources of income, including some farmers who owned fields on the wrong side of the border, many of those regions went into an economic and demographic decline. It was worse for the communities located on the east side of the border, as the state was poorer and the government of the Democratic Republic imposed stricter restrictions on its populace while doing little to relieve their economic anguish. Just to add to this, the cost of erecting and maintaining the border fortifications put a huge strain on the GDR's economy, and even to this day, we're not exactly sure how much money was thrown at it. I think it's interesting to mention here how each state viewed the border as a way to help explain their policy regarding it. For the Federal Republic, which claimed sovereignty over all of Germany, it was an inner border and was referred to as the line that marked the Soviet occupation zone. You'll often hear it referred to as the inner German border. Their view that it wasn't a border with a separate independent state can be seen in signs put along the western frontier informing the public that Germany did not end there. On the other hand, for the Democratic Republic, it was an international border, a physical manifestation of the Iron Curtain and the first defensive line against the capitalist West and NATO. While the new frontier regime significantly limited the crossing at the inner German border, a loophole remained for those who wanted to cross to the West. The loophole was Berlin. Sure, the border between East and West Berlin was made tighter as well, but it was not fully closed. Well, not yet, anyway. Since the railways between East Berlin and the other parts of East Germany passed through West Berlin, there was an easy way to immigrate to the FRG. It soon became the preferred way, and Berlin, until the construction of the wall, became the gateway for around 3.5 million Easterners who fled to West Germany. To put it into perspective, this was around a sixth of the total population of the Democratic Republic, and one can easily imagine that such a mass flight would have serious implications for the Eastern state. For the FRG, the influx of immigrants had its own challenges, but it provided an enormous propaganda boost. The Republikflucht, as the migration movement was called, resulted in a major brain drain for the GDR, as a large percentage of the people that fled west were educated. Engineers, doctors, professors, and lawyers. Another group of people whose immigration cost the GDR dearly were the wealthy farmers. They might not have been as educated as the previous strata, but their contribution was equally, if not more important, as their absence caused food shortages. The manpower losses East Germany suffered prior to the construction of the Berlin Wall were so grievous, Walter Ulbricht, the SED party leader, would later claim that West Germany owed the East $17 billion in reparations. Finally, the GDR's solution to stop its population leaving for the West through Berlin was the use of force. This was despite the city's unique four-power status that required the allowance of free travel between the different zones. On June 4, 1961, the Berlin crisis broke out when Khrushchev reissued a Soviet ultimatum demanding all military forces from all four occupying powers be withdrawn from the city, which would end the existing four-power agreements over Berlin. As tensions between the two superpowers rose, so did those between the two Germanies, and despite Ulbricht's reassuring statement that, quote, no one has the intention to erect a wall, the building materials for it had already been stockpiled and the plans formulated. At midnight on August 13th, East German police and army units began closing the border with barbed wire and fences, and by the morning, their job was done. Work then began on the barrier that would later become the Berlin Wall. For those of you interested in the details of the Berlin crisis and the construction of the wall, well, we won't be telling this story here, but it will be in a future episode. Stay tuned. So, relations between East and West Germany were certainly not the best before 1961, but the Berlin crisis and the construction of the wall itself only seemed to worsen an already poor situation. It would take almost a decade until relations between the Federal and the Democratic Republic were normalized with the introduction of a new policy approach in 1969, Ostpolitik. But that, like the wall, is material for another day. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have cleared a substantial area around the bell button to protect it, and then erect barbed wire fences and even minefields to ensure no other channel can approach it. Those with proper credentials and clearances can proceed forward to press the bell button. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at @thecoldwartv. If you enjoy our work, your financial support would be greatly appreciated via patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. This is The Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, I will leave you with the words of JFK. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air, we all cherish our children's future, and we are all mortal.